Yo, peace, love, blessings, and abundance to everybody that's out there. Today's date is June 24th, 2023, and this is day 1028. So we're just going to take it easy today. You know, I'm still fasting. Well, actually, I got 2 more hours of fasting, so that's great because I get to eat. But anyway, we're just going to be doing like 2-pump burpees, 2 pull-ups. And 2 dips. So we just constantly just do that for like 20 to 30 minutes. That'll be a wrap. But let me just say one thing about fasting. What I noticed about fasting is that, you know, my mind was telling me, even though I wasn't hungry, you know, it was just telling me to go grab a snack or grab this and grab that. You just don't know the pain I was going through just trying to fight it. I was just fighting it. Like I stated before, I wasn't hungry. It's just my mind was so used to just eating. Just eating. Like nonstop. And I'm not saying that I'm a fat ass, but you know, it's just that sometimes you eat based on emotion. Sometimes you just eat just to be eating. You know, it happens. And you know, I'm so proud of myself because I had one moment that even though I was fasting, I was stating to myself, I said, maybe I could just go grab a snack, you know, from the cafeteria and hold it for tomorrow because I know tomorrow my fasting would be over. And you know exactly what it was? It was 2 cookies. It was 2 cookies that I wanted to get from the cafeteria that I was going to eat for tomorrow, which is today. But I'm so glad that I stopped myself because I wanted to do it, but I know that what's the purpose of me fasting if I'm constantly eating junk food? And I noticed that about the food that we eat today, you know, it takes longer to digest. You know, you know the normal standard of food where you're able to digest food was like 5 hours. Now it takes about what? Like goddamn, like 8 to 12 hours before food to finally digest. I guess it's all the stuff they're putting into the food. It just makes it harder and harder for someone's stomach. So I guess by me resetting my stomach, I felt good. You know, even today, I feel real good. I feel strong. I feel energetic. Even when I got up this morning, normally I'd be so sluggish. But when I got up this morning, I was just like, damn, I really do feel good this morning. It's just like, it's not a tiredness feeling. So I think it's the food that we eat that's constantly, well, I know about me, it's like it's sort of draining me. So I sort of like cut back on eating like maybe like 3 meals a day. And I wish that's what I was doing, eating 3 breakfast, lunch, dinner. But I'm going to try to do a IF, you know, and try to eat 1 meal a day and see how that goes. But right now, again, you know, I feel good. So I know I'm talking a lot. So we're just going to get into the workout. We're going to be doing 2 pull-ups, 2 dips, what do you mean, a 2-pump burpee. That's it. 2-2. Let's go.
That's right. They're more caught up in what other people think about them than how you feel about your own personal self. So a lot of people have their brain and their mind on rent to hold a bunch of motherfuckers at work. I am paying rent on my own shit. I finally put a down payment on it. And I'm making payments every daggone day on my own fucking rent. So you don't fucking control that shit anymore, man. Oh. I got it.
2-pump.
So walk me through a day in the life. What's it look like right now?
Well,
I mean, it's gotta be crazy.
Every morning I get up, I start to get my running. Every morning, what? I need a structure with training. The training is basically structured off of my schedule. So look at my schedule. Then I say, okay, Jim and Cole, what do we have today? We have this at 7 o'clock in the morning. Roger that. That means I'm going to be up at 4 o'clock in the morning. That's how it works. That's how all my shit works. So if she lays out the schedule of events,
you just set it 2 hours early.
She says it could take an hour to get to Rich Rolls. Let's say we do 7 o'clock today in the morning. It takes an hour to get to Rich Rolls with no traffic. Okay, let's block in an hour 15 for Rich Roll. Okay, we got that. In morning time, I'm going to run 7 miles this morning. I need 52:30 for that. Roger that, put in. Shit, shower, shave, add that in. So the schedule dictates, but I have all that time.
Just push it back, right? So that means getting up at 1:30.
Trust me, I've done that several times.
Yeah. How much sleep do you usually get?
I like getting 7 to 8 hours of sleep. Nowadays I can do that. But there's times where the schedule says, hey man, you're getting 3 hours. And if that's the case, Merry Christmas. Guess what? Right now, it's easy to be happy. It's easy to smile. Those are the good times. The good times. Those times don't need to be trained. You know, I had to train myself for good times. Those times, for most people, don't need to train. What I'm trying to give you all is the misery of sometimes we go through life. Those are the times we don't want to talk about. We want to skip forward to peace. Let's get all this pain and suffering and misery of real life. Let's cover it over, nice big blanket, and let's find peace. No. Sorry. It's not possible. You got to go into that fucking hellhole of life that you have, that fucked you up, and fix it. And that's what I'm here to do.
You got to go to war with yourself before there's peace.
That's what I say in the book.
That's what you say in the book.
You must go to war with yourself before you find peace. So I'm trying to give you tools on how to do that. And I'm not going to sit and smile and be happy about it. It's a hard journey. It's a real journey. It's so crazy. That's why I look at motivation. Motivation is just a spark, but those little sparks, if somebody comes by real quick with some water, that fire is out. But if you come by, and that little fire, and that one touches it, and that little fire, which is motivation, which is kindling, and that kindling grows off to, like they call it, 1 hour fuels, 2 hour fuels, 10 hour fuels, 10,000 hour fuels, you want that thing to boil over and catch a nice big log. It's going to grow a long time. And that big log starts catching everything on fire. This is your soul. So motivation, a lot of times, can you fucking just put some water on it, puts it out. That motivation needs to turn into drive, passion, obsession to what you want to become. And once you become obsession or driven, it's a fucking inferno. So now you got to call in tons of firefighters and call in for help for here, call in for help from there. And they're not putting that shit out. Only thing that can take that thing out, it's got to burn itself out.
Obsession is self-generated. You can't will another person to become obsessed. That has to, you know, be something that is cultivated
deep
inside yourself. And most people never experience what it's like to be obsessed. And I think we put a negative label.
On
obsession. He's obsessed.
No, it's to me. Question everything you fucking do, you rot. When you are misunderstood to the point where fucking people think you're psycho and you're nuts and you're this and that, why are you in the fucking gym at 1 o'clock in the fucking morning? You just got through doing a fucking 13, 14 hours after Ranger school, man, at the gym. What's wrong? You never understand what is wrong with you.
I see you get it.
And that's why I'm so fucking glad you don't. Because I'm in the right fucking spot. When people don't understand you anymore, you're in that spot of obsession and drive. And people are like, what the fuck is wrong with this guy? I don't want to talk to you, man, because you're not going to get it. It's all about mindset. That's it, man. We have to change the dialogue within your head. And one thing I guarantee you, there's some stat out there about January 1. All that killing that we started, all that motivation, we just burn out about 10 to 12 days later. So see how far you can take that shit. I see if you can get a fucking
that is a challenge from Goggins to you.
Usually it's 10 to 12 days, man. People always come in and say, hey, I want a workout program. I don't want to do it. Because you're a waste of fucking time. Because I know most people out there, once that fucking one alarm clock goes off, the wrong time of day, I'm not going to the gym.
Right, or they get the workout program, but then they're like, hey, they hit you up again. What kind of watch do I need to get?
That's right.
What kind of shoes?
That's right.
Just keep comment keep every coming, day man. Goes by without anything going on.
Keep coming. Go to the store, buy a pair of shoes, and Merry Christmas. Have fun with that shit. Call me after you lose some other weight running your ass in the dirt, and then we'll work on some other shit. Get your base on.
Yes. Make sure I'm keeping over time.
You start to become civilized. The refrigerator gets full. You start making money, and you start. I'm not getting cold anymore. I'm retired. Once in at 40, people shouldn't be playing basketball or football or being. You start to believe this shit, and it becomes in your fucking mind. Like there's people who are retired, you know, at 47 years old or 37 years old. At 43, I'm still putting 100 mile weeks. Still doing thousands of pull-ups, thousands of push-ups, because I'm not allowing myself to become civilized. The worst thing that can happen to a man is become civilized. You lose that fucking fight. You lose that. Why the fuck am I doing this shit? I'm good. You ain't good, man. You ain't never fucking arrived. And that's just my mentality. You may have more, but you never fucking arrived. You want to be uncommon amongst uncommon people. Period.
Uncommon amongst uncommon people is one of the greatest ways to put it.
That's it. Like, if you're, like, for me, what got me in trouble with the Navy SEALs is I wanted to be one so bad. So bad. I fought my ass off. And I saw those uncommon people.
once you become a Navy SEAL, you're all Navy SEALs, so guess what happens? You're fucking common again. I want to be uncommon amongst uncommon people. I want to be the guy. I don't give a fuck if my work people don't understand me. I don't give a fuck. Once I went through this fucking joyous path of life, you ain't got in a whole bunch of fucking guys that don't fucking like me. I don't give a fuck. I'm a warrior. Period. This life has been a lot more combat than me. A warrior is not always that. A warrior is a motherfucker who says, hey, I'm here again today. I'm here again tomorrow. I'm going to be here the next day. I'm 50 years old. I'm still fucking after it. It's a person that puts no fucking limit on what's possible. And that's what got me in trouble a lot. That's why I went to Ranger School as a SEAL. That's why I tried to go to Delta Force twice. You know, I've been through all these different training programs because I was looking for, in the military, what I saw is in the training, these people get their ass handed to them. After they get out, a lot of them get civilized. I always wanted to go back in the training. And I realized that I wanted to go back to war. And the war was in that training program. And you see guys who can quit, guys who are brutal, guys who are suffering, guys who are... You go, so as a SEAL, you don't volunteer for Ranger School. I did. I put in 7 chits, got turned down, my 8th trip, got accepted. I went at 28, 29 years old. And they go, why'd you go? Because I started becoming civilized. I started becoming complacent. I need to get my fucking ass kicked again. And when you go as a SEAL going down to, you have no rank in Ranger School, you can be a major. You're just fucking Joe Brown. You're nobody. And you're not eating, you're not sleeping. So I always would put myself, I would immerse myself in shit like that. Even I would climb the ladder and I intentionally fall back down that motherfucker and say, all right, man, get soft, dude. Get soft. Kick your fucking ass again. And I, you know, it's kind of the process.
You know, it's important to always stay hungry and never get too civilized. Yes, life should be fun also, but it should also be challenging to you. You should always be wanting to grow.
You don't find yourself, if you like bench pressing, and you bench press all the fucking time, what do you find out? If you like to swim, that's all you want to do is swim, what do you find out? Put that, you know, people always, people talk about triple down on your fucking strengths.
Right.
That's the fucking weakest shit in the world. No. Triple down on your fucking weaknesses.
Yeah.
Find out something about yourself. You already know the good shit. You already know the happy shit.
Right.
That's why on my Facebook video, why don't you talk about big time? You know how to get through that shit, motherfucker. You don't need anyone to tell you how to get through that. That's happy.
Right.
That's easy shit.
Right.
I'm going to tell you how you can help yourself get through the times that suck. Real life. This is real life. 90% of your life will suck. 10% will be fucking happy. You may be a lucky guy, have a lot of fucking money, have a great ass and all this shit. Trust me. One-on-one with that fucking guy, he's missing something. His life still sucks because he had to face something that followed him his whole fucking life. Something is still eating that motherfucker up.
Almost everybody.
Everybody. Eating you the fuck up. But maybe you found a good way, how I did growing up, and how to ignore that voice that's saying, you ain't facing some shit. If I try to make it all pretty and shit, that's not what my life was. It was a violent, violent struggle daily to keep where I'm at today. I'm not gonna water it down. I'm not gonna water it down. Shit wasn't fun. It ain't fun today. I'm happy.
Don't you think that your happiness is probably elevated by the amount of pain that you've gone through?
100%.
So the amount of suffering that you understand, the amount of pain that you've gone through, makes you appreciate the happiness and the beautiful moments with much more intensity.
That's what weak people miss about my story. Weak people hear this soft kid. Oh my God, what's going on with them? You're missing the fucking story. You're not listening to the story, man. Look what I overcame. If that doesn't put some badge of honor tattooed in your fucking brain for the rest of your life, you can die today talking to Joe Rogan. You're missing the story, man. Am I happy? What the fuck did you think? Don't misunderstand the passion in which I speak for not being intensely happy. Happiest person in the world. But I'm not done. So I'm not going to speak to you like, oh man, everything's great. No, I have a lot more shit to do. So I try hard to continue to grow that. I'm trying to break a record again. I'm trying to cross Death Valley as fast as possible, top of Mount Whitney. And I'm constantly trying to put goals in front of me, but the biggest thing, I'm trying to find more of myself.
And only way I can find more is to silence the world out as much as I can, because it's getting busier every day. It's getting faster. And the faster it gets, the more you are missing who the fuck you are. So I trap my own mind a lot and say, look, man, I put my phone away, I put shit away, and I go dark. I go dark a lot, and it's because I have to find out.
All right.
I'm on a journey in life, and we all have a different journey. And I want to be in my fucking mind box, and I believe your spirit is fantastic. No way in hell I think you died. I want to be able to look back on my life when I'm all dead and so fucking proud of myself. Forever. This is all temporary shit to me. I want to be forever proud of who I was the man and change who I used to be. The liar, the insecure guy, the guy who could, whatever. I want to be proud. Like, if I die now, if I die at 8, if I die at 9, I'm going to work to something. I promise. So you look to our right, look to our left, looking for help. And if you can build that self, you can build that total accountability in oneself. And it's not about being selfish. I'm trying to create a better me. So hopefully people who are hearing this and taking it the right way can say, I can run a mile. Anybody run a 205 fucking mile, 3 or 4 mile, be the same. Ain't about all shit. It shouldn't even matter.
All right.
I want you to see how fucking far you can go. And that's all it's about, yourself. And that's where it all comes from. This was the life that you were supposed to live. But, those of you who are listening to this, whoever hears this,
come on.
You will not find purpose in a comfortable environment. You will not find it. The only way you find it is to drown yourself in a position where you're just out of sorts. We all have to be. I'm not saying you're crazy. You have the easy voice, which is that 20% telling yourself that I'm easy at 90%.
Alright,
maybe 100% at the 20%. That's that voice that we all love. That's that very comfortable voice that's that mind holding you saying it's going to be okay. Doesn't care how good you are, just loves you. Just loves you no matter how messed up you are in life. This other voice that we walk very far away from is the voice saying, hey man, you ain't doing this. So we try to get this voice out of our head completely. And we live over here in this land. So what you have to do first is turn up this voice over here. The voice saying things to you that aren't nice. That is in our head saying, you know what man, dude, you're not doing this. And it's not putting yourself down.
People take
this the wrong way in this new society. I'm not saying to put yourself down. I'm saying listen to the truth. And the truth isn't in the 20%. The truth is in this other part of your brain saying, look, man, you're wasting a bunch of percentage here. We have 80 more percent that we're not tapping into because in this other 80% is suffering,
all right,
pain, failure, self-doubt, darkness, and then a whole bunch of light. But to get to this light, you gotta go through all of this. So all of us know that. I can get over here, but over here, man, this is much better. I gotta go through this journey that is not fun. This 20 to 100%, this in between is not fun. So we decide to live over here. So how do you do that? You know exactly how to do it. You know exactly. It's not a magic trick. There's nothing I talk about in that book that's a magic trick. It's all back down to a very primitive mindset of we just have to do. It's like breathing. Breathing becomes normal. Like we didn't know that we're doing. That's how you have to live your life. When that alarm clock goes off at 4 or 5 in the morning, woo, your mind says no. You just say, this is what we do. It's what we do now. Because to get to where you want to go, the amount of pain involved, I'm not saying physical, I'm not saying you got to break yourself off. The amount of mental pain,
of how many times you're going to have to do something that you don't want to do to get to where you want to go. It's going to be, there's going to be more times you do something that you don't want to do than you are. That's your new norm. That's your new norm. So then it's like breathing. And then once you do this over and over and over again, it becomes like breathing. I don't want to live this lifestyle, but to get to the other side of this, I have to. So if you really want it, you realize what trying is and what trying is not. You're not working your butt off hard enough. You're not trying hard enough. You all think you're trying hard, but what are you gauging that off of? I talked to this one kid the other day. College is kicking my ass. I said, what are you gauging that off of? I go, are you trying? Well, yeah, I'm trying my ass off. I'm studying hard. I go, what are you gauging trying hard off of? Well, in high school, I didn't have to try at all. But I made great grades. In college, I'm trying hard. I'm trying hard right. Compared to what you did in high school, which was it came easy to you.
Last one.
So your reality is something you created off of something easy. So you trying hard is 2 hours of study. I'm going to tell you the difference in trying hard and trying hard.
Right.
Trying hard is something in your mind just doesn't stop. We know 2 hours isn't enough. When I was 297 pounds, and I was fat as hell trying to be a Navy SEAL, the scariest thing in the world to me to this day was that could have been the rest of my life. I thought then I was trying hard. That's the scariest thing in the world. I thought then, 297 pounds, working for Ecolab, spraying for cockroaches, making $1,000 a month, I thought that was me at my 100% potential. Come to find out, a few years later, I wasn't anywhere near that. 106 pounds less, graduated Navy SEAL training, went on to do all these other things. Looking back on that, that was me trying hard. That's why people gotta understand, what is in us, we have no idea until we start trying hard. And I mean really trying hard, when you're obsessed with, hey, this is my new norm. This isn't always fun. So, it's not always meant to be fun. And that's when you're trying hard. I have a haunting voice in the back of my head, a lot of us have. We just ignore it. And it was there for years. So I knew in the back of my mind that I could pull off this, whatever it was, I knew it. But I was afraid of the work. Because I wasn't gifted with brains. I wasn't gifted with God-given talent as far as like athleticism. So I knew to get to where I have to go, to be in the same playing field as these men, to even try out for this program, I knew the work was going to be something that I didn't want to even attack. So I just put it off. But yet you did. Because it haunted me. The voice in my head said, you know what, man? You're going to die never even trying to reach your full potential. I developed a reality that wasn't real. That's the thing we always do. We can have a great life, but we always build this reality about the one thing we don't have. So therefore, our great life, we don't see. We see the one piece of clothing we weren't able to get versus the amazing things we have. So we focus on that. I was the king of focusing on the one bad thing in my life. The one bad person called me in. Everything bad, I focused on that. But over here was a beautiful reality of my life. Even though I came from nothing, where I could have taken my mind, the possibility of what I can do, if I worked for it. That was always here. If I lived in the field, this was the life of me. Just by going to war with myself.
All right, six.
And putting these challenges, these goals, these obstacles, these insurmountable obstacles. So it wasn't about losing 100 pounds. Me losing 5 pounds was the top. Me losing 10 pounds, and then 50 pounds. And the more I did, the more I gained confidence. And then the more I gained confidence, the more I realized, these Navy SEALs, man. These guys can't do what I'm doing right now. I have no coach. had no trainer, had no money. I didn't know how to lose weight. I had no knowledge of what I was doing. I was working. I was a sacrifice. And then through that, all these different tools started coming up. But I would have never found these tools if I didn't put myself in a very comfortable place.
Six.
We all look for comfort. We all want it. But we look for it in a comfortable environment. You will not find comfort in a comfortable environment. Those of you who are listening to this, you ever hear this, you will not find it. I will try and look for it everywhere. The only way you find it is to drown yourself in a position where you're just out of sorts. Where you can't swim, you're drowning. Where you're drowning. You're drowning in life. And you say, you know what, man? I'm gonna figure out how to backstroke something. And then you figuring out all these tools. Your mind starts to, when you quit, your mind does this. Because you're out. Once you say, I'm not gonna quit, this is the 40%. When you quit, your mind says, we're done. So it doesn't expand. There's no expansion when you quit. When you say, this sucks, I'm drowning, I'm miserable, I'm suffering, I'm broken, but I'm not going anywhere. What happens to your mind is it does this. It says, he's not leaving. So we gotta expand. We gotta grow. We gotta figure this thing out. So then these compartments in your brain start to happen. They have to work. They have to work. And then you start to engage parts of your mind you never engaged before. But you can't engage it by sitting back in these nice chairs, drinking this nice water, talking to you, talking about what I want to do. That's where the 40% thing comes in. It comes in when you're in suffer mode and you say, I'm not going to quit. You're forcing your brain now to operate on a level it's not used to. But then it becomes used to.
You know what, I don't have the word for it, but if I grew up this day and age, if I was a millennial or whatever they call it nowadays, you know David Dodd, no one's ever heard of me. So I'm very blessed that I grew up in the time frame that I did, because there is no mental toughness, there is no self-discipline. Everybody gets a trophy, and I hate to say it, but you're gonna in life.
Well, I mean, society in general has gotten weaker all across the board. So that trickles over, that kind of spills over to the school system, to the education system.
All right.
And kids are paying for that now. Kids are paying for the simple fact that there's a lot more pressure on them and they're weaker minded. Think about that. Society now is weaker minded and there's a shit ton more pressure than what we had in Europe. I'm 43 years old, and I look at society now with how hard it is to keep up with everybody else. Because why? You can look at your phone and see how great the whole fucking world is. Because the whole world is only sharing what the fuck they want you to know about them. You're not sharing, their bad shit, how hard life really is, what they're trying to overcome and all those things like that. So,
and that's what makes you an absolute winner. About the fact that you are, we're doing these kids a huge injustice.
Almost there.
I'm talking about this today. So the only way you're going to fix yourself
all right,
being
10.
No place and being soft and being a weak person is honestly, you have to be really raw. I invented this thing years ago called the accountability there. And it's how you cure the no-sex epidemic. You put yourself in front of a piece of air, watch people make the word and do whatever you're doing. And only you know how fucked up you are. We can lie to everybody, you can lie to your girlfriend,
right,
you can lie to your boyfriend, you can lie to people at school. You can't lie to yourself. So what I did was I lied so much and I was so insecure growing up, was that how I cured my snowflake is I got in front of a mirror with just meaning my pathetic self.
All right.
And I thought
of
all over this mirror, a about how stuck I am, about what I need to change for myself, about how I feel. I need to attack my life, the situations that I'm facing, the situations I'm face to face, to start to man up. And that thing right now, it's not getting any better right now. This world, the U.S., we are soft and soft as you. You can't say a thing. Everybody gets offended. Everybody's got a movement going on, no demand. It's just, everybody's so thin-skinned. And you don't get better that way. You just get worse. Yourself in the mirror and say, okay, I'm bitchy, I'm whiny, I complain, I have an 8-hour job that only works 3 or 4 hours a day. We have to really bring it back to ourselves.
So basically, and once again, I'm not a tough guy. I'm not a tough guy. I realize I have to become a tough guy to succeed in society.
Right.
Well, for me, the reason why I did that is I realized that I was the awful truth, the easiest. And this is the mindset behind me. If I'm going to go through the hardest training, I want the hardest spot in the worst position in the hardest training in the world. And what that does is, if my mindset is going to the hardest place, like in Hungary, if you carry the boat, the toughest spot to be in is the number one spot. Heaviest part of the boat, and I never left that position, because the more your mind searches for a comfort, any kind of comfort, it will continue what to find more and more of it. But the way I train my mind is, I want to find the hardest location known to man, and then my mind continues to go that way versus the other way. Because once you start giving yourself a way out, oh, you know what, I'm going to run 5 miles today. Cool. I'm going to run 4 miles. You know, for me, it's like, no, I'm going to go the opposite way. So my mind continued to get harder and harder and harder, because I knew the second I gave it a way out, it was going to take it. And I also wanted to choose the hardest way, because it was my way of motivating people. So how I motivate people is, because I was a broken
person,
and how I motivate people, it gives me the suckiest mother thing on the planet Earth, and watch me see itself.
Really?
And I go back to the number one spot on that boat, the heaviest thing known to man. You're gonna look at me and say, Roger that. Let me follow this guy. So I do by example. I do the hardest shit. The people follow me, say, yeah, that's what I want to do behind that mother right there.
Hey, pull up.
And nothing, but no one came to save me. I didn't win a trophy. I was a bad student, and people told me I was a bad student. People told me I was a failure, and I was going to be a loser. While those words were harsh, you have two options to have those words in front of you. Either stack it up, or else go be a and go high. I mean, that's the thing about it. People think that this is something that every day, it must be a routine for David. Yeah, it's a routine, but the routine goes like this. I wake up, I feel sorry for myself, I don't want to do it, and I say, hey, you need a stack it up.
Got three more.
I had to be the mother that could take anything, that could carry any straw.
Three more.
That nothing can hurt me. No, can't hurt me.
Nowadays, we want everything to come over fucking night. All of our results have to come today. If I lose 106 pounds in less than 3 months, pretty daunting task. But if I had the mindset of I have to lose 106 pounds today, like it took me 18 months.
I disappeared.
I literally lost. I failed 3 times to be a Navy SEAL. It took me 18 months. Be a Navy SEAL. The program's only 6 fucking months long. So what we have to do is we have to set our new norm. Our new norm.
All right, let's see.
What does that mean? Our new normal. When I was in SEAL training, I was getting the shit kicked out of me every fucking day, and I kept on getting rolled back to day one. Rolled back to day one.
All right.
Most people would have fucking quit. But my mindset became this. This is my new
two by
norm.
Two.
My new normal is I get up at 4 o'clock in the fucking morning, I get my fucking ass kicked every fucking day in my life. There's nothing outside of this world. This is my life. Like, people who become healed up, these prisoners of war. If they can't change their mind and think, this is my new fucking normal, this is my life, this is where I live.
Alright.
You have to become a judge.
Three. I mean, six.
A lot of people say, yeah, you have to be able to look beyond this. Sometimes the pain is so miserable, the suffering is so intense.
Six.
You look too far beyond anything you look for. Everything you do, you could die. So to be a warrior, why people don't understand me, I'm glad you understand me. Merry Christmas, good on you. Because being a warrior takes a whole different mindset. A whole different mindset. You know that there's a great chance I may not be in war. I was in 21 years. I'm lucky. I'm very lucky that I'm alive. And it's hard to be able to still run. But if you sign up on that dial line, you get sent like a SEAL. Your mentality changes. I may not live. You accept it. That's the mentality. And that's what makes you warm. If you're scared to die, you're dead. I wasn't born this motherfucker. I made it. That's the bottom of insecurities,
four.
Fear, self-doubt, lies. With me, buried in the fucking field position. How about that? Being honest with you, being truthful with you, and then fix it.
Warriors, real warriors, and I want to say that is a whole different mentality.
So I've worked with people who had the courage to jump on grenades and kill themselves to save them.
that's the kind of mentality it takes to be a SEAL. Does every Navy SEAL have it? Nope. But that's what SEALs are, that's what we try to, that's why the Navy SEAL training budget is so hard. We're trying to find that person who's willing to go the distance. And the distance is your life. So if I'm talking to people right now, maybe what I say to you does not resonate because why you're not willing to give your life to someone. Every SEAL, I can't speak for everyone. Most of us are. A lot of people go fight for this country. A lot of them are.
All right. That's it.
Am I talking bad about? No, don't take it. Twist my words. You like to twist words. I thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for that. A lot of people are scared. Navy SEALs are scared also. But a lot of us have a way to realize what we have decided to do with our lives. And it takes a great sacrifice. That sacrifice can be your life. And that you have to be able to do that. Become a warrior. If you go into combat scared, you can be scared, but you can't be so scared it makes you afraid to fight. That makes sense. We're able to control that, and a lot of us are able to put ourselves in hell and become the devil.
That's it.
At the end of the day, the worst thing that can happen to a man is he becomes sick.
Woo! That's it. Gotta sign up and go eat. Peace out.